Welcome to Zion Lutheran Church. I am Pastor Steve. It's so good to have all of you joining us here today. Welcome to our third and final midweek Advent hymn sing and worship service. Welcome to all of you who are joining us today in the parking lot, as well as those who are joining us from home, either via the internet or the radio. A special welcome to our friends joining us from Diamond Willow, Carefree Living, Bethany Good Samaritan, and Edgewood Vista in Baxter. We are blessed, all of us, to be worshiping together. I know many of you desire to support the Lord's work here at Zion in Brainerd through your tithes and offerings. Those tithes and offerings could be mailed here to the church office through the postal system. They can be sent online at zionbrainerd.org by clicking on the little black box that says Online Giving for Zion Lutheran Church, or by using the Give Plus app on your smartphone. If you haven't yet had the opportunity to download that app, it can be found at either the App Store or Google Play. Once it is downloaded, you enter the church's zip code 56401 to search for Zion Lutheran Church in Brainerd. Make sure you find the right Zion Lutheran Church, because there are quite a few Zion Lutheran churches. From there, you'll be able to set up either a one-time gift or a reoccurring donation. I would like to thank everyone who has already participated in the Hindsight is 2020 Debt Reduction Fund Drive. By the grace of God and your generosity, we have passed the halfway point for our goal. Also, thank you to everyone who has sent in their 2021 commitment card. This will help in budgeting process for the next year. If you haven't already, please continue to prayerfully consider how the Lord is calling you to participate in and support His ministry here at Zion. And please, if you haven't already, send in that commitment card to the church office. We have now completed all of our scheduled Zion Vision recasting meetings with great success. Thank you to all who participated. There is a lot of great discussion and a lot of great ideas. We'll be looking to host some more sessions after the first of the year. If you are listening to the worship service today being broadcast somehow, either on the radio on Cash 95.9 or watching online either via YouTube or Facebook, and would like to receive a printed bulletin to participate in the service, there are a few ways that you could manage to make that possible. One, you could have the bulletin and announcements, well, they're already located on our church website. So all you have to do is click on those and download those for your use at home. You can also contact the church office, and they will find a way, arrange a way to have that sent out to you. Or you can stop here to the church, and out in the parking lot there is a new mailbox that says bulletins on it. You can stop and pick up a bulletin there for the Wednesday services. They are out there by Tuesday afternoon, and for the Sunday service, they will be out there by Friday afternoon. And finally, the church council continues to monitor the county's COVID-19 new case number. We are anxiously awaiting Governor Wall's announcement later today, which is scheduled for this afternoon, as well as the new case numbers, which come out on Thursday. As of now, we unfortunately will again not host in-person worship services for this weekend. Today's midweek Advent service is being live streamed and recorded at noon and aired at 6 p.m. on Cash 95.9 FM. This coming Sunday service will be live streamed and recorded at 8 a.m. and aired at 11 a.m. on Cash 95. We are going to hold in-person Christmas Eve and Christmas Day worship services. Yes, that's right. We are going to do live in-person worship services for both Christmas Eve and Christmas Day. The services on Christmas Eve are at noon, 3, 5, 7, and 11 p.m. And Christmas Day, there will be a Christmas morning service at 9 a.m. These services are all by reservation only, so please call the church office and reserve your spot. Spaces are filling up. We begin our time together, our hymn sing together, by singing our opening hymn. It is printed in your worship folder, or it'll appear on the screen. What child is this? What child is this who laid to rest on Mary's lap is sleeping, whom angels greet with anthems sweet, while shepherds watch our guard and angels sing. Haste, haste to bring him, Lord, the babe, the Son of Mary. Why lies he in such mean estate, where rocks and as are feeding? Good Christians fear for sinners, hear the silent word is pleading. Nails, spears shall pierce him through, the cross he sends gold and myrrh. Come, peasant king, to own him. The King of kings salvation brings. Let loving hearts enthrone him. Raise, raise the song. And as we look there into the manger at the babe, the Son of Mary, we are going to continue by singing Away in a Manger. The cattle are no crying he makes. I love thee, Lord Jesus, look down from the sky and stay by my cradle till morning is nigh. Be near me, Lord Jesus, I ask thee to stay close by me forever, and love me, I pray. Bless all thy dear children in thy tender care, and take us to heaven to live with thee there. We continue by singing our next hymn, It Came Upon a Midnight Clear. We are going to sing verses 1 and 2. It came upon the midnight clear, that glorious song of old. From angels bending near the earth to touch their harps of gold. Peace on the earth, goodwill to all, from him to gracious King. The world in solemn stillness lay to hear the angels sing. Still through the cloven skies they come with peaceful wings unfurled, and still their heavenly music floats o'er all the weary world. Above its sad and lowly plains they bend on hovering wing, and ever o'er its babble sounds the blessed angels sing. We continue by singing our next hymn, Gentle Mary Laid Her Child, verses 1, 2, and 3. Gentle Mary laid her child lowly in a manger. There he lay the undefiled to the world a stranger. Such a babe in such a place, can he be the Savior? Ask the saved of all the race who have found his favor. Angels sang about his birth, wise men sought and found him, heaven's star shone brightly forth, glory all around him. Shepherds saw the wondrous sight, heard the angels singing. All the plains were lit that night, all the hills were ringing. His name in all the earth. Hail the King of glory. We continue by singing, Hark the Herald Angels Sing. We will do verses 1 and 3. Hark the herald angels sing, glory to the newborn King, peace on earth and mercy mild, God and sinners reconciled. Joyful all ye nations rise, join the triumph of the skies, with the angelic host proclaim, Christ is born in Bethlehem. Hark the herald angels sing, glory to the newborn King. Hail the heaven-born Prince of Son of righteousness, light and life to all he brings, risen with healing in his wings. Mild he lays his glory by, born that man no more may die, born to raise the sons of earth, born to give them second birth. Hark the herald angels sing, glory to the newborn King. We now sing our last hymn together. We stick to the angels' idea as we sing together, Angels We Have Heard on High, and we'll sing verses 1, 2, and 3. Angels we have heard on high, sweetly singing o'er the plains, and the mountains in reply, echoing their joyous strains. Tidings be, which inspire your heavenly song. Gloria in excelsis Deo. Excelsis Deo.
to Bethlehem and see him whose birth the angels sing. Come adore on bended knee Christ the Lord, the newborn King. Gloria in excelsis Deo. Gloria in excelsis Deo.
Well, thank you all for singing along. Hopefully that was good for you. Hopefully it wasn't too painful as it was for Jonathan and Jackie having to listen to me and me alone sing. It would be great if we were all here singing together. Jesus is the son of scandal. As we unpack Matthew's genealogical history of Jesus, we find several scandals in his family tree. Are people innocent? Well, people not so innocent. People involved in incest, prostitution, adultery, and murder. But our gracious Lord brought good from bad, even going to the cross to include us. We are all prodigal children, now joined to the body of Christ and heirs of heaven only by the grace of God through our baptism. And so we pray to the Son of Scandal, come quickly, Lord Jesus. We start with our opening sentences. Although Nathan condemned David, you have struck down Uriah the Hittite with a sword and have taken his wife to be your wife. She bore a son, and he called his name Solomon. Paul writes that although we ourselves were once foolish, disobedient, when the goodness and loving kindness of God our Savior appeared, he saved us. When John baptized Jesus, a voice came from heaven, "You are my beloved Son. With you I am well pleased." We read responsively Psalm 71, verses 1 through 12. This psalm, prepared perhaps by David, reflects on a life marked by scandal and conflict. In you, O Lord, do I take refuge. Let me never be put to shame. In your righteousness, deliver me and rescue me. Incline your ear to me and save me. Be to me a rock of refuge, to which I may continually come. You have given the command to save me, for you are my rock and my fortress. Rescue me, O my God, from the hand of the wicked, from the grasp of the unjust and cruel man. For you, O Lord, are my hope, my trust, O Lord, from my youth. Upon you I have learned from before my birth. You are he who took me from my mother's womb. My praise is continually of you. I have been as a portent to many, but you are my strong refuge. My mouth is filled with your praise and with your glory all the day. Do not cast me off in the time of old age. Forsake me not when my strength is spent. For my enemies speak concerning me. Those who watch for my life consult together and say, God has forsaken him. Pursue and seize him, for there is none to deliver him. O God, be not far from me. O my God, make haste to help me. In you, O Lord, do I take refuge. Let me never be put to shame. We sing together our next hymn, O Come, Emmanuel, verses 1, 2, and 3. First reading, although David had Bathsheba's first husband killed in battle, their son would be the great King Solomon. A reading from 2 Samuel chapter 12. Nathan said to David, "You are the man. Thus says the Lord, the God of Israel, I anointed you king over Israel. And I delivered you out of the hand of Saul, and I gave you your master's house and your master's wives into your arms, and gave you the house of Israel and of Judah. And if this were too little, I would add to you as much more. Why have you despised the word of the Lord to do what is evil in his sight? You have struck down Uriah the Hittite with the sword, and have taken his wife to be your wife, and have killed him with the sword of the Ammonites. Now therefore, the sword shall never depart from your house, because you have despised me, and have taken the wife of Uriah the Hittite to be your wife." Then Nathan went to his house, and the Lord afflicted the child that Uriah's wife bore to David, and he became sick. David therefore sought God on behalf of the child, and David fasted and went in and lay all night on the ground, and the elders of his house stood beside him to raise him from the ground, but he would not, nor did he eat food with them. On the seventh day the child died, and the servants of David were afraid to tell him that the child was dead. For they said, "Behold, while the child was yet alive, we spoke to him, and he did not listen to us. How then can we say to him, 'The child is dead'? He may do himself some harm." Then David comforted his wife Bathsheba and went into her and lay with her, and she bore a son, and he called his name Solomon, and the Lord loved him. O Lord, have mercy on us. Thanks be to God. For our second reading, in our baptism, God's grace was poured out on us richly. A reading from Titus chapter 3. For we ourselves were once foolish, disobedient, led astray, slaves to various passions and pleasures, passing our days in malice and envy, hated by others and hating one another. But when the goodness and loving kindness of God our Savior appeared, he saved us, not because of works done by us in righteousness, but according to his own mercy, by the washing of regeneration and renewal of the Holy Spirit, whom he poured out on us richly through Jesus Christ our Savior, so that being justified by his grace, we might become heirs according to the hope of eternal life. O Lord, have mercy on us. Thanks be to God. The third reading. For all of us in the body of Christ, the verdict on him, my beloved Son, is ours by the grace of God. A reading from Mark chapter 1. John appeared, baptizing in the wilderness and proclaiming a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins. And all the country of Judea and all Jerusalem were going out to him and were being baptized by him in the river Jordan, confessing their sins. Now John was clothed with camel's hair and wore a leather belt around his waist, and he ate locust and wild honey. And he preached, saying, "After me comes he who is mightier than I, the strap of whose sandal I am not worthy to stoop down and untie. I have baptized you with water, but he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit." In those days, Jesus came from Nazareth of Galilee and was baptized by John in the Jordan. And when he came up out of the water, immediately he saw the heavens opening and the Spirit descending on him like a dove. And a voice came from heaven, "You are my beloved Son. With you I am well pleased." O Lord, have mercy on us. Thanks be to God. She bore a son, Solomon. He saved us according to his own mercy. Not because of works done by us, he saved us according to his own mercy. He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit. He saved us according to his own mercy. We sing together the sermon hymn, "Joy to the World." We will sing verses 1 and 4.
Heaven and nature sing, and heaven and nature wonders of his love, and wonders of his love, and wonders, wonders of his love.
Please pray with me. May the words of my mouth and the meditation of our hearts be pleasing in your sight, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Jesus, the son of scandal. Oh, what a great word that is. There's nothing going on in our world where the word scandal could be at all associated with anything happening anywhere, right? Because we are so perfect and righteous and holy and good and nice, nothing scandalous about us. So why then would we call Jesus the son of scandal? Well, listen again here to Jesus' genealogy as recorded by the gospel writer Matthew. The book of the genealogy of Jesus Christ, the son of David, the son of Abraham. Abraham was the father of Isaac, and Isaac the father of Jacob, and Jacob the father of Judah and his brothers, and Judah the father of Perez and Zerah by Tamar, and Perez the father of Hezron, and Hezron the father of Ram, and Ram the father of Amminadab, and Amminadab the father of Nahshon, and Nahshon the father of Salmon, and Salmon the father of Boaz by Rahab, and Boaz the father of Obed, and Obed by Ruth, and Obed the father of Jesse, and Jesse the father of King David. And David was the father of Solomon by the wife of Uriah. I'm just going to stop there. The first portion of David, or of Jesus' genealogy from Abraham to David. There's three names listed there. Three names that if they were in your genealogy, you would somehow find a way to erase those three names. We'll work backwards. We already did a little bit of the reading of David and Bathsheba. Bathsheba, the beautiful woman who lived next door to the castle where David, king of Israel, looked over the side of his wall on some afternoon, and there bathed Bathsheba naked. David looked at her and was impressed. So he sent some of his servants to go invite her to come and spend a little bit of time with him. One thing led to another thing, and after she had been home for a few days or weeks, she sent a message to David saying, "David, I am with child." Which would have been bad enough if it was just the neighbor girl, but the neighbor girl was married. So David had an affair with a married woman, brought her husband home from the war, tried to make him think that somehow he had impregnated his wife, tried to trick him into spending intimate time with his wife so that everyone would believe that it was Uriah's child, but Uriah was too good of a guy. He wasn't going to go and spend time with his wife and enjoy the pleasures there while his friends and co-soldiers were in battle, risking their life. So since David could not trick Uriah into spending special time with his wife, he sent back with Uriah a note to the guy in charge and said, this is what I want you to do. Put Uriah in the place that is the most dangerous. Have him be the one leading the charge. And when he gets out there, then pull back so that he could die. Not only did David, the king of Israel, have an affair with a married woman, David, king of Israel, went and killed the husband of the woman. I'm pretty sure if that were me, somehow I would try and find a way to erase that portion of my family tree. If we go back a little bit further, it says, and Solomon, the father of Boaz, by Rahab. And then it says, and Boaz, the father of Obed, by Ruth. Two women listed there within two generations. The second one, Ruth, was a Gentile, somebody who is not an actual part of the Israelite clan. She was a Moabite. She was not a part of the group. She was not a part of what should have been the family tree. She was an outsider. The fact that she was listed is scandalous. We wouldn't want her to be there. She's not really one of us. If we go back to Rahab, Rahab was a prostitute. She worked and lived as a prostitute. And then she married Boaz, an Israelite man. Again, not somebody I would boldly bring home to mom. Scandalous. But if we go back to the first name, the first woman named in Jesus' genealogy, Tamar, and Judah the father of Perez and Zerah by Tamar. Judah had two sons about the same age, and then Judah had a third son. Judah's oldest son married Tamar, and he died, not giving her children, so he gave Tamar to his second son to be his wife. He did not have children with her, and he died as well. Judah promised that he would have Tamar be the wife of his youngest son when his youngest son came of age. But as Judah's youngest son grew into the right age, Judah thought to himself, now, you know, she's been married to my other two sons. I'm thinking it's probably not the safest to have her married my third son. So Judah one day went for a walk to go visit some friends. And as he was out there visiting on the road, there was this woman who was dressed as a prostitute. And so Judah went and spent some special time with this prostitute who was veiled so he couldn't see who she was. But as he left, she kept back a few of the items that specified him to be the one. And a few months later, Judah found out that Tamar was pregnant. His daughter-in-law by two sons was now pregnant. Excellent. So he was going to have her put to death. And as she came to speak with him, she asked him, by who do you think these are? This is the individual who is the father of my child-to-be. Judah realized it was him. Would you want that in your family tree? Would you like that known by everybody? definitely big eraser. Erase that story as well. I want everybody to think that I come from a good family with no skeletons in my closet, genealogically speaking. Unfortunately for us, more importantly, is the fact that I do have a lot of skeletons in my own personal closet. I have sinned in ways that I am not proud. I have sinned in ways and things that I have done. I have sinned greatly against God and others. If you would know all my sins, all of my skeletons in my closet, you too would think that my faith by itself would be considered scandalous. How could God love somebody like me, somebody who's done so many things that are detestable in his sight? That's me. How about you? What skeletons are in your closet? A night of indiscretion, a DUI, whiskey plates, the taking of an innocent life, time in jail, your tongue, the two-edged sword that has cut apart relationships and friendships and family. What in your life makes God loving you seem scandalous? Think about it this way. God himself calls himself the bridegroom, and us, the church, he calls his bride. I don't know about you, but I, as the bridegroom, really want to know that my bride is faithful. But that's not what we are as humans, as sinners. We are not faithful to God. We are not loving and kind in response to him. We live apart from him. But God, in his love, loves us in spite of our sins. God loves us so completely that he would come to suffer and die and rise again so that we would receive the gift of forgiveness and eternal life. God loves us so much. It's scandalous. We don't deserve it. We are unfaithful. But God in his love loves us completely. And prayer is that God will help us. Help us to look past our sins, to bring our faults to the cross of Christ, and repent for our sins and receive his gift of forgiveness, of washing away of all of those sins, so that we are now set free, so we are now perfect, not because we've made ourselves so, but because God has done that for us. We pray. God, help us to follow your great love for us. Help us, Lord, to turn from our past sins and to live in love toward you. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. We continue with the salutation and collect of the day. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Lord Jesus, guide and protect clergy and lay leaders of your church. Enable them to lift people's hearts and minds to look beyond global pandemics, natural disasters, and political upheavals to see the eternal kingdom, which you have graciously opened to all people who trust in you for life and health and peace. Bless those who toil, till the soil, manage farms, transport supplies, and distribute food and clothing where they are needed. Son of David, hear our prayer. Almighty Lord, give wisdom and courage to those who lead governments. Command armed forces and maintain order in society. Give them hearts to seek peace, so that warfare with neighboring states and civil strife within them give way to prosperity, health, and cooperation. Increase our faith to depend on your eternal promise of a better country that awaits us by grace. Son of Abraham, hear our prayer. Jesus, light of the world, open the hearts of all who are burdened by their scandals and of past sins. Surround them with faithful people to tell them about your coming in human history, to give yourself for them. Protect and guide all law enforcement personnel, first responders, healthcare workers, and counselors. Help them balance justice, mercy, and compassionate care so that many may have their lives repaired and hope restored. Son of scandal, hear our prayer. Gracious Lord, cared for by your adopted human father, Joseph, remember people like him, those who have been forgotten, whether dispossessed, incarcerated, or isolated for any reason. Remember not their sins and iniquities, but give them a sense of your abiding presence. Nurture in us all a love for you and your will, so that we will obediently do whatever you ask. Son of Joseph, hear our prayer. Servant Savior, born in a stable to a lowly virgin, remind us again that you turn the world's ways upside down. Give strength to the weak. Lift up the downtrodden. Provide hope for the despairing. Announce peace to the distraught. And proclaim eternal forgiveness to all burdened by their sin. Son of Mary, hear our prayer. Lord Jesus, the people included in your family tree dealt with scandalous sin within and around them, and yet from them you graciously entered human history. Help us to see your grace at work in us. We who have been grafted into your family tree by baptism, strengthen us to truly be your forgiven and adopted brothers and sisters. Son of scandal, hear our prayer. Lord Jesus, we implore you to hear our prayers and to lighten the darkness of our hearts by your gracious visitation. For you live and reign with the Father and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. We pray together Luther's evening prayer. I thank you, my heavenly Father, through Jesus Christ, your dear Son, that you have graciously kept me this day. And I pray that you would forgive me all my sins where I have done wrong, and graciously keep me this night. For into your hands I commend myself, my body and soul and all things. Let your holy angel be with me, that the evil foe may have no power over me. Amen. And we pray together the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Let us bless the Lord. Thanks be to God. The Almighty and merciful Lord, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, bless and keep you. Amen. We sing together our closing hymn, Go Tell It on the Mountain, verses 1, 2, and 3. Go tell it on the mountain, over the
born. While shepherds kept their watching o'er silent flocks by night, behold, throughout the heavens there shone a holy light. Go tell it on the mountain, over the hills and everywhere. Go tell it on the mountain that Jesus Christ is born. The shepherds feared and trembled when lo, above the earth rang out the angel chorus that hailed our Savior's birth. Go tell it on the mountain, over the hills and everywhere. Go tell it on the mountain that Jesus Christ is born. Down in a lowly manger, the humble Christ was born. And God sent us salvation that blessed Christmas morn. Go tell it on the mountain, over the hills and everywhere. Go tell it on the mountain that Jesus Christ is